A team of Philippine Central Bank employees gets an award for its efforts in developing a key reform initiative that now enables the wider use of digital payments in the country. We are joined today by Bridget Messina Romero, the Acting Deputy Director of the BSP's Payment System Oversight Department. Good morning, Ms. Bridget. Thank you for joining us.
Good morning, Nikki, and to all your viewers.
All right, so first off, congratulations to the National Retail Payment System core team of the BSP. Very much deserved. So could you tell us more about the NRPS team, as well as the motivation for the development of the team's framework? How did the pandemic affect your timeline?
Thank you. Thank you very much. The NRPS first, it stands for the National Retail Payment System. And the motivation for the development of this framework started several years ago, actually. It was then under the Governor Titangco and the late Governor Espinilla. They were the ones who first discovered that we had a low digital payments adoption in the country when a diagnostic study was conducted way back in 2015. So at the time, our level of digital payments adoption was only at around 1%. And we were surprised because the Philippines is actually considered one of the pioneers in terms of the regulations of electronic money issuers, which was really a very progressive regulation, in fact, all over the world. So we identified the barriers and challenges as well as opportunities that we can take advantage of in order to widen the adoption of digital payments in the country, because we saw then that there were really a lot of benefits being enjoyed by other countries who have in fact accelerated the use of e-payments in their respective countries. And as for the members of the NRPS core team, with respect to the award that you mentioned, we are led by the Senior Director, Raymond Estrojo. He's a director of the Payment System Oversight Department. And together with me, I have Mr. Jay Dizon, Ms. Annalisa Resines, and Mr. Herman Constantino. But I have to also mention that because the NRPS is a very, very big project, over the years, we have to include and we have to really expand our scope in terms of team membership. So we have a lot of members already by the time that the year 2018 came after like 15 years, four years after the initial launch of the NRPS.
And could you share with us some of the most challenging issues that you had to face when you were implementing the NRPS projects? And of course, how the pandemic impacted the development of the team.
The most challenging parts of the development of the NRPS is the engagement of a major set of stakeholders. We had to get the views from the key players in the financial industry, from the government, and definitely experts from from multilateral organizations such as the USAID EPESA team, which is now which was headed by our now Deputy Governor Tangonan. So all of these inputs we had to gather, and then we have to process them because we needed to develop a customized regulatory framework that's tailor fitted to our domestic payments landscape. So that was the challenge. And then the next challenge was the implementation part. And it's very fortunate that our Governor Jokno really prioritized this payments digitalization agenda when he took the helms of the BSP. So it helped us build value added services. We have the PESANet and the InstaPay, and then we built this eGov Pay facility that allows individuals to pay the government the fees, taxes, and clearances in digital form. And we also have already this national QR code standard that can be used for person-to-person payments if you need to send remittances or allowances to your family members. And we're on the pilot run of this person-to-merchant payments. It started only last April 30. So all of these services, we believe, help Filipinos, especially during the pandemic, where we have limited mobility and we still have to perform our obligations in the safety and convenience of our homes.
And again, Ms. Bridget, let's zero in on that. How has the payments digitalization agenda and e-payments initiative of the BSP helped Filipinos, most especially during the pandemic? And what are the benefits to reap from a cash-light society and a growing digital economy?
Yes, during the pandemic, I'll give you some examples. The PESANet was used to disburse the social aid that came from the social security system for the employees affected of the MSMEs, the micro, small, medium enterprises. So they have the small business wage subsidy program. And then we are also working with the DSWD for the conversion of the, for the use of a transaction account to receive that SAP, the assistance, the social aid from the government. And the PESANet is also being used now so that all of the SSS disbursements, such as the pension and other benefits of the SSS, can be made through electronic forms. So these are just some examples where the government used the digital payment rails that we have established long before the pandemic struck. And then we're trying to utilize, as of the moment, we have several projects. We want to build further on the digital payment rails that we have. Mm-hmm. So we're trying to really maximize the use of these facilities. As to the benefits of digital payments, there are really a lot of studies already on the benefit of digital payments in the country. Of course, we want to improve the economic status of the country. We want to have a, we want to have a sustainable economic growth that's also inclusive, so that all Filipinos will be able to reap the benefits from a growing digital Philippine economy. And from the businesses and the government side, there are a lot of cost savings too with respect to, for example, handling of cash and transportation, safekeeping. So there are definitely opportunities there. And for the financial and payment service providers, there are also savings in terms of, there are also benefits rather in terms of their expanded market. Because when you use digital payments, you are able to also formally introduce the unbanked into the formal financial system. And then you're able to offer them services such as other services, such as lending, insurance, and other types of in services such as investment. But we use the digital payments agenda as the first step because it's really the most basic and the most used among the financial services. And almost all Filipino adults make make payments. So that's why we see that digital payments can be a gateway to financial inclusion as well.
Right. And now, Ms. Bridget, we also know that the BSP unveiled the Digital Payments Transformation Roadmap last year. What is this project about and when is it expected to be rolled out? Do we also have other projects promoting digital payments that we can expect in the coming months?
Yes, thank you for asking about the roadmap. This is actually harmonization and unification of all the efforts of the BSP. As I mentioned, Governor Jokner really prioritized the expansion of financial inclusion and also the further digitalization of payments in the country. That's why we developed the BSP Digital Payments Transformation Roadmap for the years 2020 to 2023. And our objective under this roadmap is to increase the share of digital payments up to 50% and to onboard at least 70% of Filipino adults into the formal financial system by having transaction accounts. And we have some key initiatives to digitalize payments. And examples, an example of which I mentioned earlier is the use of the national QR code standard, which we call QRPH, for our payments to merchants. When we have to, for example, buy from the grocery, from drugstores, from hardwares, we only need to bring our mobile phone, for example, and just have to scan the QR code and we'll be able to pay. We don't even have to maintain an account with the same payment service provider. So that's the important part there. It's interoperable. That's what we call it. It's interoperable. And another facility that we have is the Bills Pay facility. It's slated to be implemented early next year. And this one seeks to really unify the fragmented bills payment facility in the country. So right now, we can only pay if we maintain accounts within the same financial institution or payment service provider. So, but with the Bills Pay facility, this will be running on InstaPay. It will be interoperable. So the merchant or the biller does not have to maintain the account in the same financial institution as the payer. And we also have the request to pay facility, which is essentially just for example, if I want to send money to you, Nikki, I'll just send you a request to pay and you just need to confirm it. So it will be that easy. You don't have to get all my personal information. Yeah. Yes, and you don't have to type in my account number, for example. And then finally, we have some initiatives in PESINet. We have the multiple batch settlement, which just increases the number of cycles in a day. And what this means is that the recipients can receive the funds earlier. Mm-hmm. So that's very good for our businesses because they use PESINet, it doesn't have a transaction limit, unlike Instapay, which has a transaction limit of 50,000 pesos. Mm-hmm.
Just when you thought it couldn't get more convenient, no, wow. Yeah. And Attorney Bridget, on a final note, these services, these PESINet, Instapay, eGovPay, and QRPH, these innovative payment services that Filipinos are now enjoying, as we have been talking about, have now proven essential amid the pandemic. So any tips on awareness about the responsible use of digital payments on our end? How can we make sure that our data and money, you know, are safe?
Yes, thank you for asking that because it's relevant for all of us. Mm-hmm. So what the BSP has actually launched a digital literacy program. And part of this is our cyber hygiene practices that we want to really spread awareness about. So among these practices, first, we always say not to share your personal information, especially your PINs and your passwords. And then second, you must use very strong passwords and PINs. And then third, whenever you receive, for example, text messages or emails, you have to check if it's from a legitimate source. For example, if it's from a government agency, you should check if it's from @gov.ph. That's already one indication that it may not actually be from a government agency if it doesn't have that @gov.ph. And if you really have doubts, you should contact your financial service provider that there is a potential of a fraud that you received, let's say via text or email. You should contact them right away and they should be able to assist you. And finally, the BSP also has this consumer assistance mechanism. If you go to our BSP website, we have a chatbot, which we call Bob. So we call it the BSP online buddy. If you have any concerns that you want to elevate to the BSP, you can go to our BSP website and then you can use our chatbot service.
All right, that's good to know. Thank you so much for joining us, Attorney Bridget. Please stay safe.
Thank you too for having us.